Good morning, Mountain View. Good morning. I hope it's a joy and you're excited to be here this morning. I'll tell you, in the first service, that last song really got a hold of me. I don't know what it's like for you during your week. You know, we're all different. We all come from different backgrounds, different stories, different challenges. But I tell you, the last words of that song, do you ever come in here on a Sunday morning when you just feel like the night of Saturday is still holding on to you? But the power of that song says, but the Lord is holding on. So I don't know about you, but I feel in my own life sometimes that although you may feel, and I don't know what that grip feels like of Saturday, but it's nothing compared to the grip of a loving God upon you and me today. Amen. Nothing can compare. So I just hope you hold on to that as we get into this day. We're in the middle of experiencing God. For those of you who have been with us for a while, we're walking through a study in a small group. I'm teaching, trying to stay away from the book, the workbook you're walking through, and kind of saying, God, what do you have for me to teach? What do you have for me to learn? That's kind of where it begins. And so I wanted to bring up on the screen, you'll see it at home. Guys, thank you for joining us from home as well. The seven realities, if you're brand new to experiencing God, you can look at all of them. Here, I'm just going to just read the first five, the ones we've walked through. God is always at work around us. God pursues a continuing love relationship with you that is very real, very personal. God invites you to become involved with him in his work. Number four, God speaks by the Holy Spirit. That he does. I focused on that a couple weeks ago. Through the Bible, prayer, circumstances of church, revealing himself, his purposes, his ways. Last week, number five, we focused on that God's invitation for you to work with him will always leads you to a crisis of belief that requires faith and action. And today we're talking about this idea of adjustment. When I went through experiencing God for the first time, probably over 20 years ago now, never really even had a clue of this whole idea of adjusting our lives to God. But you must make major adjustments in your life to join God in what he is doing. And so that probably was the biggest aha for me. And even coming back in time number eight, I'm walking through it now. Even that adjustment time is very important. And we're going to look at that today. We're going to talk about adjustment. It may be challenging for some of you, but here's why I'm bringing it up. When you and I face this, I'm using Henry Blackaby's term, when you and I face a crisis of belief, or if you were walking through the workbook last week, you may remember if you one of the little pieces there talked about the Greek word for crisis is decision. One of the words, so a decision of belief. Do we believe when we've heard God speak to us, ask you to do something? Maybe it's outside of our comfort zone. Most likely is because it's a God-sized task, whatever that task may be. We have to come to the point of answering the question, do we believe? It's a decision of belief. Do we believe that the God that we love and serve is able to do what he said he would do in the context in that moment? Can he give us what we need? Can he give us the wisdom, the hope, the perspective, the resources, the power, the energy, the wherewithal to do what he's asking us to do? That's that decision of belief. When we finally come to that point, then we will move into having to make the necessary adjustments in our life to join God in what he's doing. And here's why, because I don't know about for you, I can just speak for me, I kind of wrote this for myself, that when it comes time to making adjustments, we're going to have to move some things in our life because you and I can speak for myself, have created emotional, relational, sometimes physical constructs in our lives that are the escape hatch out of which I can get out of something if I get into something and it's failing. And so it's emotional, it's physical, it's relational. I'm kind of creating these little fail safes in my life that, Lord, whatever I'm adjusting to, whatever I'm trying to do, if it's not working out, I'm out of there type thing. And I can avoid the consequences or I can avoid the heavy circumstances and things like that. Now, I will say this. Whether you're a student and you're in a school facing a teacher or a principal, whether you're an employee at work facing a boss, whether you're in a church and facing a life group leader or a ministry director or a pastor, if you get called out, and I'm talking about in a moment where kind of everybody around us knows that God's talking, God's moving, and even kind of you would agree with it, you're just not doing anything. When your activity gets called out on the carpet, most of the time we have these social constructs, we have these sayings in our mind that we go back to try to get out of it. I started thinking, does anybody ever like take inventory of these sayings? And sure enough, went back, and of course you can probably find anything on the internet you want to, but I went back and actually found this. It was called America's Top Most Used Excuses. See, it's out there. And I say, don't be busting anybody. See, you're always saying that. I don't want to hear that. Now, I'm walking through this. I should have done, you know, the Tonight Show type thing where you start at the bottom. I'm going to start at the bottom, going all the way to the number one. That's not my, that's his job, not mine. I'm waiting for the okay, just excuses. How was I to know this was different? It's not my department. That's the way we've always done it. Boy, it sounds like you took it right from church. You know, I didn't know you were in a hurry for it. Really? I asked you, looked at your sweat in your eyes and told you to do it. Wait until the boss comes back and asks him. I didn't think it was that important. No one gave me the go-ahead. That's the one again. That's called a manager, not a leader. You know, no one told me to go ahead. And the number one excuse is, I forgot. Blah, you know, we all use that. That's what Google Calendar's for. And Google Reminder. Now, it was at this moment during the first service, halfway through this list right there, and that light right there exploded. Pow! Circuits went out, lights went out, glass was falling from the sky. It was really kind of an emotional moment for all of us. But I tried to find a reason in there that I could blame somebody else when it's not my job. Trying to find a reason, going, how do I get out of this one? You know, and so thank God no one was hurt, and it's still not working, but at least it's cleaned up. So you guys are safe over there right now. You know, I'm walking before I down. Now, for the rest of you, I have no idea. You might want to make an adjustment right now where you're sitting. I want to give you an illustration from the scripture of an individual who had a difficult time making an adjustment, and rightly so. And I believe we can learn from that today, because it's not just something that people dealt with 2,000 years ago. You dealt with it before you walked in this door today. I probably dealt with it this past weekend type of thing. To get specific, let me ask you this. Have you ever found it difficult to work with someone or to adjust your life to someone, to a group of people that you found suspect or suspicious? Put it that way. Imagine for a moment, I'll use that phraseology for a reason. Imagine for a moment a man in the scripture named Ananias, and he's been asked of the Lord to offer assistance to a well-known murderer of Christians. Remember, God is speaking to this man, asking him to offer assistance to a well-known murderer of people just like him. Now, most of us were raised, I can't say exactly how you were raised. I was raised to be a little bit suspicious, or maybe the better word, careful around strangers. But Saul of Tarsus was no stranger to Ananias. I mean, if they had TV in the moment, that would be like you turning on, it wouldn't matter what news network today. It could be MSNBC, it could be Fox News, it could be CNN, and they would be rolling the scrolling tape of the video of this man killing Stephen. We found that in the book of Acts. And now you're watching that ticker tape go across there, and now God's asking you to adjust your life and go minister to this guy. And you're like, man, God's like falling on his head. But I recognize, and I'm hoping you will as well as we walk through this, that I believe that our greatest accomplishments come that as you and I learn to adjust our lives to God. Now, Saul has just met Jesus on the road to Damascus. I was able to use that exploding light there in the first service because he had a blinding light. You know, it kind of got his attention. That all got our attention in the first service. And here's a guy, he's literally on the very road. He's got letters from the high priest. He's heading to Damascus where Ananias lives, and he's going to arrest and imprison all the Christians he can find. Now, he meets Jesus Christ, the one he's denying, and he has this great bright light experience, and he can't shake it off because when he gets up, he's blinded. He has like scales on his eyes. He has to be escorted into the Damascus where he's led to a very specific house. And the Bible says this about Saul of Tarsus, macho guy, knows everything. And so the Bible says for 3 days he was blind and he didn't eat or drink anything. I personally think he's fasting. Some people say he's scared. I'm thinking this guy's on a 3-day fast and he's not eating anything, he's not drinking anything. As Saul waited there in that 3 days, he can't do anything. He's waiting for further instructions from God. Okay, now God, what are you going to do? That very same moment, God is interacting with Ananias in another part of town, giving him very specific instructions. Now, if you read this scripture in Acts chapter 9, you have to go forward to Acts 22. Now, Acts 22, they define who Ananias is. And this is how, it won't be on the screen, but it said, Ananias is a devout observer of the law and highly respected by all the Jews that live in there. That's Acts 22, 12. You want to look it up. He is a devout observer of the law, highly respected of all the Jews who lived there. What I thought to myself was interesting was you could have taken Ananias' name out there and put Saul of Tarsus in there. We wouldn't have known the difference. Because both men were exactly the same, that both men were individuals who greatly accomplished. They were devout observers of the law. They were highly respected among the Jews, except The Bible says that this guy, Ananias, is a believer. He's willfully surrendered his life to Jesus Christ. I mean, Saul had to have that dramatic experience there on the road to Damascus for that surrendering to happen. But the Word of God says this, and what I love about this is because he calls him a disciple in verse 10. Now, there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias. And the Lord said to him in a vision, Ananias, and he said, "Behold, here I am, Lord." Now, I'm going to challenge you for a second, as I've been challenging myself thinking this through. They explicitly said, here's a man who's a disciple. Not he's a fan of Jesus, not he's a churchgoer, which churchgoing is great. Glad you're here. Glad you're participating from home. That's a good thing. But oftentimes in the busyness of our lives, when God's trying to speak, we're like, too busy, God. You want me to do what? That's too hard, God. Let me move on by what our agenda. But they made Ananias a disciple. And when God speaks to a disciple, he said, "Behold, here I am, Lord." I started scratching my head thinking, is there anything important in that? I thought, well, yeah, God probably has to start doing a little research going, all throughout the scriptures, those who feared God, who loved God, surrendered their lives to God, when God spoke, that's what they said. Went back to Abraham in Genesis 22, God comes to him, "Behold, here I am, Lord." Genesis 31, Jacob, when God comes to Jacob, "Behold, here I am, Lord." In Exodus chapter 3, when God comes to Moses, "Behold, here I am, God." When God comes to Samuel in 1 Samuel chapter 3, "Behold, here I am, Lord." There's something here. It's not like, hey, God, when I got a minute, I'll show up. God, I gave you Sunday. The other 6 days are mine. In the moment when God comes to a disciple of Jesus Christ, "Behold, here I am, Lord. What do you have for me right now?" And so I started thinking about that, going, wow, okay, if that's the case, do I have instances of this throughout Scripture? Now, I couldn't find people actually saying this, but I thought, Lord, are there people that are known or unknown that have adjusted their lives to God, that have gone on to do amazing things, or because of their ministry, it's touched thousands? So we have known and unknown. So I was just going to put the names up there, but it hasn't decided. So I thought, well, doing some research on some people, John Stolfitz, if I said that correctly. Anybody know that name? He helped lead Martin Luther to Christ. Protestant Reformation, kind of here because of that. Pretty important. John Eglin, anybody heard of him? Adjusted his life to God. Instrumental in the conversion of Charles Spurgeon, my favorite preacher, called the Prince of Preachers, 1800s all across Europe. Some of you have heard Mordecai Ham. But most of us know the name of the person he led to Christ. A man who adjusts his life to the Lord and touches a young man named Billy Graham at Tent Revival. I put up there the name June Minor. Most of you probably don't know her. Sixth grade Sunday school teacher at Stevensburg Baptist Church. Absolutely instrumental in my life when it comes to what this book really means. So for those of you who are teaching our surge ministry upstairs, for our middle schoolers, thank you. Because you have no idea what you're doing. You're adjusting your life and your schedule to touch them. You have no idea which one of those might go out there and touch one, touch 10, touch 1,000. You have no idea. The question is, we never know how God might use an unadjusted life to touch the millions. For me, lives adjusted to the purposes of God yield fruit for eternity. This morning, I'm sitting there at breakfast. I'm thinking about that. I'm thinking about this word adjustment. And suddenly the thought comes into my mind. I go, wow, God, thank you for that thought. That's kind of a scary thought. I thought, what does Satan want from me? He wants me to abandon the life God has for me. What God asks is he wants me to adjust my life to the life he has for me. And I'm sitting there going, the enemy is always the exact opposite of what God wants for us. Lives adjusted to the purposes of God yield fruit for eternity. And so I looked at the scripture in verse 11, 12. Look at what it says. The Lord said to Ananias, said to him, "Go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, and he's praying." Very specific. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him and restore his sight. You know what I love about my God? A lot of things. But he's into details. And I love details. The Lord gives very specific instructions to Ananias. This is where you're going to find him. This is what I want you to do. And all the time Saul is praying, he's getting the download from God. There's this guy coming, and his name is Ananias, and he's going to lay hands on you, and the scales are going to fall off, and you're going to get up and get baptized. Hear me. When you're going out there and you meet somebody throughout the week, God may have run into a divine encounter. You may know it's coming. You may not know it's coming. It may be an easy cross section of your life. It may be somebody that's not easy for you. But you have to ask yourself, God, you don't intersect people for no reason at all. There's a purpose in this. The easy ones, man, we think, oh, God, this is easy. I had a great time today. The hard ones, it's no accident, God. Why is that person right here in my life right now? But do we take this time to stop and say, Lord, is there anything in this moment? Maybe I'm at Chick-fil-A. You want me to say, hey, come on over and eat with me right now. Is there any adjustment you want to make in the moment? Well, God, I can be about your work. So the word of God says in verse 3, Lord, Ananias answered, because not all the divine appointments are easy. And this certainly wasn't. Talking about adjustments we don't want to make. I have heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your holy people in Jerusalem. And he has come here with authority from the chief priests to arrest all who call on your name. I believe for me, as I'm reading this, I'm thinking, I have hard things in my life, you have hard things in yours. But that crisis of belief, as we talked about last week, will always have to be won before we're ever willing to consider the adjustments in our lives. It's almost like, for me, I wasn't there. I can't put words in mouth. I just see the words you wrote. But it's almost like saying, God, I know you kind of know everything already, but just in case you didn't watch the news, this is a murderer. He's coming to actually imprison, and maybe he'll kill me like he did had Stephen killed. God, are you sure this is what is right? Are you sure this is what you want me to do? And here's what I call this, because I do it. It's called a prayer protest. Ever done it? Now, I'm not talking about murmuring. That just looks unspiritual. But when you go to prayer and you're just like putting your foot down, throwing a tantrum in the presence of God in prayer, it looks more spiritual. But I call them prayer protest, because we're trying to say to God things we already know he says it. But somehow, as if I'm just going to bring it to his mind and imagine, he's going to let me off the hook. It doesn't work that way. Here's a prayer protest, and for me, a crisis of belief, we talked about this last week, crisis of belief will always lead to us having to exert faith, and that faith is always going to actually end up in action of some type. And so for me, the ultimate measure of faith is how you and I respond to things that appear illogical. It's important that you hear that word, because if you can figure it all out, maybe God's already revealed something to you, or probably maybe it wasn't God to begin with, maybe it wasn't God's size, it wasn't an invitation from God. It's that ones that are illogical. And I started thinking about what we're going to do as a church, because this really could be anything in life. Could be a family, could be a marriage, could be health, could be finances, whatever it is. God, you're asking me to do something, but it just doesn't seem right, because I'm up here in my head. I'm up here in my logic. I'm up here in the impossibilities. And I'm thinking about why we've invited the church family back tonight. We haven't actually kind of done something like this before. It is a time tonight where we come together to talk. Not about opinions. What are we hearing God say? Collectively as a church, no matter who it is, young or old, doesn't matter. What is God saying to you about what you are part of a fabric of a body of believers and where you believe God's headedness and where you feel God is leading, the part that God is showing you? We all need to hear that to get a greater understanding of the revelation God's trying to bring up. But sometimes, like things we're trying to do as a church, it seems in our head, it seems like let's get together and let's talk about the litany of impossibilities of things that God wants us to be about. And sometimes that's difficult. Matter of fact, I think it's in the program as well. We're not doing any voting or deciding decisions. That's on the 18th of November. But I actually think they put something in your program this week that talks about, here's the very things we're going to talk about. Here's the decisions we're asking people, do they hear God? So if you haven't read anything about this, don't know anything about it, you see behind me, that's the front page of our website. Go to that little purple box right there this afternoon, click it. It'll bring up a PDF you can read of something I've read to the leadership of the church. It brings up a video, it's an hour and a half long, but really you only have to watch the first 20-some minutes of it. Just kind of get abreast of what we're talking about. But sometimes it feels impossible. So I'm sitting there thinking this through because I'm up in my cranium and I'm spending too much time up there these days. I believe the adjustments that God is asking us to make, and I believe the same will be true for marriage or finances or health or whatever. The adjustments we need to make will forever avoid if we choose to put our foot down in the dirt of our own logic. If we can figure it out, boom, God just doesn't make sense. So I'm having a crisis of belief right now. So by faith, I'm not exerting faith. And so Jim Ammons, older guy, he's such a good friend. Elder, he just finished his term, but he'll always be a good friend because there's so much leadership depth. And he said, Mark, he said, I just thought you were going to do this, but it's so true. He said, you know, when Justin lies, if you put your foot down the dirt of your own logic, this is what you're going to do. That's about how far you're going to go. And when you get tired of that, you'll be like, God, I just don't understand that. This is what you're going to do, and you're going to do this. I thought, Jim, that's beautiful. God's asking us to pick our feet up and put our feet into the waters of his wisdom. Amen. Because it's there where God, what is wisdom? It's applied knowledge. Knowledge that he gives us. He learns, teaches how to apply it into a very unique situation. And even then, we're going to have to exert faith. So I'm sitting there going, can you imagine Ananias? No, God, this is illogical, not him. Didn't you watch the news forecast? Didn't you hear what they said about him? God, why do you want me to lay hands on him? That man will never change. God, why would you call this church to multi-site ministry? Lord, that just seems illogical. Don't we have enough ministries going on here, Lord? Aren't we trying to do things around this building? Why do we have to worry about a building somewhere in Orange County? Why would you ask us to do that, God? Hey, am I going to lose people up here that are going to go down there? Am I going to lose pastors that are going to be working down there? I don't want to lose people that I love. That seems illogical, God. Friends, there are 600 people in this church. 600 people God could call out into a mission field. And my mind starts rolling again. God, why would you call this church to be a catalyst to birth addiction recovery ministries, Christ Center in this community? Why would you do that? God, don't we have enough things going on? We have enough building things. Where are we going to get $1 million, God? Somebody to buy the place. And then where are you going to bring these leaders and these counselors from? Lord, bring Culpepper. Are they here, God? I don't know. All the logic, putting the foot down in your own logic, and what do? That's what we do. Sometimes that gets embarrassing when people see it from the outside. How about forgiveness? Getting into the Thanksgiving, Christmas season, where you're going to be sitting at the table with sometimes people you're uncomfortable with. Sometimes you're glad you only see them twice a year, maybe once a year. If you're honest with yourself, it's uncomfortable. And in that moment, God's been speaking to your spirit that you need to let that go. What they did to you, what they said to you, what they said about your wife, what they said about your kids. And God's been saying that to you, but you haven't done it. And if you keep putting the foot down the dirt of your own logic, you'll never adjust your life to him. But when God sees something so much bigger, maybe you will. And see, that's what Ananias saw. He was given a gift that sometimes we don't see in the beginning. Ananias was having a prayer protest, and he didn't really want to do what God was asking him to do. But in that moment, God painted a picture for him, a bigger picture that he couldn't see. All he could see was the murderous threat. He could see the possibility that he himself might die if he walked into that house. But he could not bring himself to see, because he couldn't, he's human. He couldn't see the bigger picture, and God gave him the bigger picture. Verse 15. The Lord said to Ananias, go. This man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and to the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. Ananias, like many of us, are worried about how much he's going to suffer if he obeys. That's what often happens to us. We're worried about us. I get it. God painted the picture of what this man is going to become. This man, skuos, is the Greek word for vessel. He is going to become a vessel, a container, a bucket, a 50-gallon drum in the hands of God to bring the gospel of life to the Gentile world and to their kings and to the people of Israel. Anybody here thankful he became that vessel? Amen. We're here because of that. Because he was the vessel in God's hand. But Ananias couldn't see that. But God painted the bigger picture. Folks, sometimes you think, God, I don't want to forgive them. I don't want to look across the table at Thanksgiving and say, I love you, despite what you did. I don't want to do that because it hurts to even bring it back up again. But God's like, but I see a bigger picture for that guy's life if you set him free or you set her free. Or that, God, I don't want to go into multi-center. It's just too complicated. But God says, I see a bigger picture for Orange County. You can't see it. I could just run down through the litany of excuses that I've made in my own life. In that moment, he says, you're going to be that vessel. So the Bible says, then Ananias went to the house. He adjusted. He entered it, placing his hands on Saul. He said the words I can't believe he said. Every time I read it, I pause. Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus has appeared to you on the road. As you were coming here, he has sent me so that you may see and be filled with the Holy Spirit. This wasn't an obligation. Ananias walks in, stands off to the side. Saul, be healed. Out the door he runs. He didn't do that, did he? He walked in. He's like, some of you need to walk into your Thanksgiving or Christmas and look at people in your life that you've been separated from and say, sister, brother. He put his hands on him. You know why that adjustment is so hard? Because that is an emotional adjustment that has to happen in. Sometimes we can obey God even though we're still standing up in rebellion on the inside. And that's the way we serve the Lord. God, I'm going to figure out an escape route, my own escape route. If this goes bad, God, I'm out of here. Hands on his head, brother. God spoke to you. He spoke to me, and I'm here. And although you've killed a friend of mine in Jerusalem, and you came to arrest people like me, I call you brother, not because of you, but because of him. And here's what gets my attention in this. Here's a man who is willing to forgive. Most of us would say, okay, God, I'm willing to forgive, but here's the problem. How can I be assured they won't do it again? We can't, can we? What I love about this picture is that in that moment, he laid his hands on him and those scales fell off. He had absolutely no indication in the flesh that in that moment, he would not turn on him and arrest him, except for the fact that in his crisis of belief, he had decided that the God that he had bent his knee to when he sent his son Jesus Christ into the world was able to not only do for Ananias, but was able to do to that murderer and transform his life. When people at the CARS ministry say, I'm an addict, but I know Jesus, I say, you're a Christian that used to struggle with addiction. You got the wrong definition first. Define who you are and let the purposes of God be realized in your life from there. And so I just looked at, I keep walking through this and say, so many of us are saying, God, I want the assurance before I adjust my life and step out there where it may fail. God, I can't give. Can I give anybody in this room or anybody watching at home 100% foolproof that the CARS ministry in this town in the flesh that we can make it work? God said it's going to happen. That's what I'm trusting in. Can any of us in this room or at home guarantee that multi-site will be a success? I can in the flesh. God's opened the door, and we're asking ourselves, what is my assurance or who is my assurance? I was sitting at my desk the other day working on this, and my mind begins running through all the, but God, I can't promise. I can't promise. You know, it's easy when it's yourself. And you could do something if it fails, you're kind of like, oh, backtrack. But when you're representing 600 people and you can't give that assurance, God was almost screaming. I took my hands off the keyboard. God said, Mark, I am your assurance. What about you? And the things that you don't know yet because your foot are stuck in the dirt of your own logic. And you're just doing this and it's getting old. It's all you can muster. You're even flinging your arms now to make it look like you're doing something. God, you are my assurance. You are the one who is able. And so I'm going to ask the band come as I speak this last words to you because God gave this to me a couple days ago. I've really been wrestling with it. When we raise kids, if you had the privilege of raising kids, and maybe you're on to grandchildren and great-grandchildren now, we talk about, it's a phrase, I'm not even sure I like it. It's called like raising well-adjusted children. What does that mean? Kind of looking it up going, well, The best I could come up with, if I'm saying that, God, I really want to raise well-adjusted children, is that in this world today, there's a lot of complexities. And a lot of times we learn by failure, so we need to be there for them. So I would say that raising a well-adjusted child is a child that has grown up through the extreme complexities of life. They've made mistakes. They've had consequences of safety, but hopefully they were small in their consequences. And so, but we've walked them through it to greater understanding and greater knowledge and greater skill. And so now they've grown up is that, yeah, they're still going to make mistakes, hopefully less and less of them, but they understand how to navigate the complexities of life. Well, I'm sitting there thinking about this, and the reason it comes up is because this whole world adjustment. And I thought about, what about your life and mine as Christians? What about us as a church? Does God look down on you? If you're a Christian here, you're a Christian at home. You've surrendered your life to Jesus Christ. Does God look down on you today? Does he look over there at the elders in heaven? And does he look at the great cloud of witnesses and say, hey, 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 do you see that? Do you see her? Do you see her? That's a well-adjusted daughter of mine. Did you see him? Do you see what he did? Do you see what he didn't do? Man, that's a well-adjusted son of mine. Right there in the midst of the complexity, he heard my voice. She took my opinion. She took my counsel. She adjusted. He adjusted to my life, their lives to me. And look what happened. That's my girl. That's my boy. And then I started thinking about the church. We collectively as a body are the bride, or we're children of the Most High God. Keep the analogy going. When God looks down on us, does he say to himself, Mountain View? Yeah. They got sin, repentance, confessions there. But you know what? That's a well-adjusted church. A well-adjusted church that walks through the crisis of belief. And they don't adjust their lives to the situation. You understand, nobody is asking us to adjust our lives to that person who needs forgiveness or to multi-site. Or to cars. We're not adjusting our lives to a program. We're called to adjust our lives to him. So I'm going to ask you to pray with me for just a moment. God, I believe, Lord, I have been spending the time this week. I am believing that you are speaking and that through this message, this time of worship, the music has been phenomenal already. It's just going to get better. Lord, if there's some adjustments you want us to make, Lord, and there's, for many of us, God, we have had both feet, not just in the dirt. We've been stuck in the dirt so long that it's filled up with water and it's mud now. And they were stuck in the mud of our own logic. And if that defines you as a child of the Most High God right now, I'm asking you, just between you and God, you just say, God, I confess that. There are things you've asked me to do in my life. There are things you're asking me to do right now. And I can't figure out why you would ask me or how it's going to work out. And I have to admit to you, God, that right now my feet are stuck in the dirt of my own logic. I repent of that. Lord, my assurance will never come on the other side of my obedience. My assurance is always in you. And thank you for reminding me of that today. You and you alone are the one that I am assured of all the days of my life. You said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. You didn't say I'd be successful or I'd fail. You said you would be present with me. I'm asking you to pray. And if God is bringing up the name of someone, a face in your mind, of someone that God has given you the ministry of reconciliation, I'm asking you. And if some of you right now, you don't even need to, I'm talking to prayer, so God, I need to pray to you. Lord, I pray that someone won't even sit here long. They'll just get up and go do what they've been asked to do. Radically orienting their lives to you. Now, my friends, you sit here in this room today, you walk with Christ, or you don't have a relationship with God. You've pushed Christ off until today, and you recognize, you know, that was just stupid. God loves me enough to send me a Savior, and I've rejected him. But today in this place, I'm recognizing that, you know, I need to adjust my life, not to people. I need to first adjust my life to God, and the way he makes that possible is through his son, Jesus Christ. And for the first time in your life, you're finally getting that. Thank God. This is a great day. I encourage you right where you sit. You don't need the church for this. You don't need a pastor for this. You need Jesus. And right where you sit, to own it and say, God, I have rejected you all the days of my life. But today is different. You're my assurance. And I trust in you today. And I invite Jesus Christ, your Son, into the very crevices of my life. Take it all, Lord. You can have every bit of it. Bring your light into my life to illuminate the things that don't need to be there. And God, for the rest of my life, help me learn how to get rid of that stuff. That the very life that I live, the very thoughts that I think would be in line with yours, Lord God. I want to be like Ananias. I want to hear you speak, and I want to learn how to radically obey. If that's your prayer in this room today, I encourage you to tell somebody before you leave. Tell me during the time of worship at the end. Tell someone that brought you. Write it on the connection card. Say, I gave my life to Jesus because God's my assurance. And Father, I'm asking today as we stand to sing a response to you, Lord, that you would open the eyes of our heart wide open, that we see what we need to see and deal with what we need to deal with. So, Lord, as we stand, may this be a word sung back to you as a response. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together in a time of response to sing these words. If you want to talk to somebody, as we did in the first service, as people came, please come. Talk to the person beside you. Don't let this time go by if the Lord's speaking.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. See you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Help us to see them through your eyes. Help us to adjust well.
daily basis. Lord, we want to see you. You are holy, set apart, and so good. Have a blessed week. Adjust your lives to who He is this week. Experience His love and peace. Go in peace.